Problem three. Let ABC be a triangle with angle ACB less than angle BAC less than 90 degrees. Let X and Y be points on AC and the circle ABC respectively, such that X and Y are not equal to A, and BX is equal to BY, which is equal to BA. Line XY intersects the circle ABC again at Z. Prove that BZ is perpendicular to AC.
So we're going to study this geometric configuration. I'm going to show you how to do the question in a way which is actually rather quick, but it's not what I expect people to find first off. When you've got a geometry configuration, you have to play with it. You have to study it, you have to find its properties and try and work out what's really going on somehow. In the end, you write up a proof. And if you're in a hurry, you just write it up in a rushed way. For this presentation, I've had plenty of time to think about this question and I've found a really polished way of presenting it. But don't be fooled, right? This is not what I expect any of the students will do in the exam. So we find the other point X on AC such that BA is equal to BX. That's clearly a unique second point. And we draw the perpendicular bisector of AX, goes up here, to a point, I've called it Z dash, but it's not specified where it is yet. We'll worry about that in a minute. Now you've got this line across the bottom of the triangle, BC, and what you can do is to reflect X in that line BC, and it'll become the point down here, which I'm going to call Y dashed. Now, you draw the line Y dashed X up until it meets that perpendicular bisector, and that's where you locate the point Z dashed. Now, the points Y dashed and Z dashed have aspirations. They dream that one day they will become Y and Z. And our job is to show that that happens. So let's do some maths and try and prove that's true. Now this triangle BAX is isosceles. So its base angles are equal, and I've written dots to indicate the equality of those two angles. There's another two angles which are clearly equal. If we look at BXC and BY dashed C, well, one angle is the reflection of the other, and so those two angles that I've marked with arcs, they're also equal. Now something interesting happens. If you take a dotted angle and an arc, they're on a straight line, so they add up to 180. That means that the angle CAB and the angle BY dashed C add up to 180. But that's exactly what you need for the quadrilateral ABY dashed C to be cyclic. And Y dashed dreams have come true. It lies on the circumcircle of ABC. And so we can promote Y dashed and turn it into Y. So now let's turn our attention to Z dashed. Let's try to turn it into Z. And we can do that if we can show it's on the circle ABC. And we do this with a little angle chase. So I've marked in the angle BCA and with a colored dot. And there's a reflected angle just below that must be equal. So this is angle C of the original ABC triangle. So most importantly, the angle YCB is equal to the angle C. We've got a couple of little right-angled triangles in this configuration marked on the diagram caused by those reflections. And of course, if you know one angle in a right-angled triangle, then you know the right angle, and you know that the other one is 90 minus the first angle. So you can identify them. So this angle here, we know what it is. It's it, when added to the angle at C, will give you 90 degrees. The vertically opposite angle must be the same. And then in this other right-angled triangle up here, you have the same argument. And so the angle up here, which is, if you like, YZ dashed B, must be equal to angle C. They're the same color as marked. Now we use converse of angles in the same segment. You see this angle is equal to this angle. So in fact, this point must lie on the circumcircle of the triangle formed by these three points. But that's circle ABC. So that's exactly what we wanted. The dreams of Z dashed have become true, and Z dashed has become Z. So we've done it, we've solved the problem. But let's think about the method that we used. What we did was we drew the original configuration without the circle. We introduced new points defined by lines and reflections and so on. These points were Z dashed and Y dashed. We then thought about the circle and tried to show that Y dashed and Z dashed were on the circle, and they were. But we were able to use standard theorems of geometry, because it's like angle in the alternate segment, or it's converse, opposite angles of a cyclic quadrilateral adding to 180. These are very handy, very powerful. It's quite easy, often, to show things, to show that a point lies on a circle. We could have done it another way. We could have used the circle to define the points Y dashed and Z dashed, and then show that various lines had properties. Three points lie on a line, or perhaps two lines were at right angles, that sort of thing. That would all work, okay, but it would be more work. So this is I'm just recommending this method as an approach when you've got a diagram with a circle in it. So I'm going to develop something I'm going to call the reflection fact. So we start with triangle ABC, and we draw its altitudes. The lines from each vertex, which are perpendicular to the opposite side. There are three of them, and it's a famous result that those three lines meet at a single point. The name of that point is called the orthocentre of the triangle, and it's traditional to denote it by the letter H. Now, the reflection fact is this. If you reflect H in each of its sides, you land on the circumcircle. Quite remarkable fact, very, very useful. How do you prove this? Standard circle theorems. So I'm not going to show you. It's in any book on Introduction to Geometry, or even better, prove it yourself. Deploy standard circle theorems that you learn for public examinations and prove it. Another way of looking at it is if you took circle ABC and reflected the whole circle in one of the sides, the resulting circle would pass through the orthocenter. So if you took all three reflections of circle ABC in each of the three sides, those three circles would meet at the orthocenter. Anyway, the reflection fact is this wonderful piece of information that the orthocenter reflects in each of the sides to a point on the circumcircle. So this is another way to do the problem using the reflection fact, which I just mentioned. So we provisionally define Z to be on the perpendicular bisector of AX. AX was defined as before. And this time we'll let Z hit this beyond the circle. Now, look at the triangle ZBC. This point, A, is on its altitude. And X is the reflection of A in the line BZ. That means that this point here, X, must be the orthocenter of triangle ZBC by the reflection fact. So I've highlighted the triangle ZBC in a color, so you can focus upon it. Now X is its orthocenter, so if you reflect X in its side BC, what happens is you land on its circumcircle, which is the same as the circumcircle of ABC. So we've got the point Y down there. Because it's the reflection of X in BC, then of course this distance from B to Y is exactly what you want. Now, let's think about this line through Y and X. Well, of course that's an altitude of this triangle. And so that altitude must pass through the vertex, and everything's done. So a little knowledge is often dangerous. In this case, a little knowledge is extremely powerful, and you have a very fast way of doing this problem.